Between the black skies and my red eyes, I can barely see. And when I'm feeling like I've been let down, like the friends of my family, I hear the rain reminding me. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. And you alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When my hopes and dreams are far from me and I'm running out of faith, I see the future I pictured slowly fade away. And when the tears of pain and heartache are pouring down my face, I find my peace in Jesus' name. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. And you alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm.
Everybody has trials and temptations. Everybody knows heartbreak, isolation.
Yeah. worship this morning. I hope you like that song because y'all are going to sing it next week. Are you excited? So welcome to First Christian Church. I don't think there are any announcements this morning. We have some information about small groups showing on the screen. So if any of those look interesting to you, you are invited to plug into them. Also, we have cards on the table. Some are green, some are yellow, some are, they're all different colors. If you are visiting with us this morning, we would love to have you fill out one of those cards and drop it in the offering plate up here or on either one of the side tables. Also, if you have a prayer request this morning, we have a prayer group that meets at noon on Thursdays, and you can write that down on that card as well, and they will pray for you. They will pray for your request. Jillian, do you have anything? Are you just, yay, all right. So at this time, if all the children under the age, so if you'll go with Miss Jillian for children's worship. And in the meantime, let's all stand and praise God together. It's another peppy one. So get your dancing shoes on and you're clapping.
My feet are on rock. Ooh, ooh. I can feel the water rise. I can hear the howling lies that haunt me. Fear won't hold me now. My feet are on rock. My feet are on the rock. Ooh, ooh. I can see the morning light. I can feel the joy of the horizon. Here my faith is found. I stand on solid ground. My feet on the rock.
On Christ's solid rock I stand, on all the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock.
On Christ's solid rock I stand, on all the ground is sinking sand.
So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock.
On Christ's solid rock I stand, on all the ground is sinking sand.
So stomp your feet and clap your hands.
My feet are on the rock.
Ooh.
My feet are on the rock.
I am counting every blessing, counting every blessing.
Surely your goodness pursues me. Surely your heart is still for me. I will remember your mercies all my days. Through every storm and gale, I am counting every blessing, counting every blessing, letting go, trusting when I cannot see. I am counting every blessing, counting every blessing, surely every season you are good to me. I am counting every blessing, counting every blessing, letting go, trusting when I cannot see. I am counting every blessing, counting every blessing, surely every season you are good to me.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath. Shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Shout your praise, our hearts will.
Good morning.
Good to see you. How are you? Like that shirt. Walk right up and wow, isn't that? He always has great shirts. He really does. Notice his shirts. Good to see you all this morning. So glad you're here. Some of you back after being gone for a while. Sometimes I wish you could see what we get to see, right?
Yeah.
All these beautiful smiling faces. My goodness. Some of you may be here for the first time. I want you to know you are so very welcome here. For those of you who are here each week, you know you are here not just by divine appointment, as I often say, but by divine assignment. You are exactly where you're supposed to be. For some of us, we're here for different reasons. For some of us, our spouse dragged us here. For some of us, our parents dragged us here. For some of us, we're here every week. For some of us, we didn't feel like being here. For some of us, we could not wait to get here. But whatever the reason you are here, you are exactly where you're supposed to be, and we are glad that you are here. We want you to know that you are perfectly welcome in this place. Who is welcome here, church? Everyone is truly, truly welcome. And why is that? Because every person in this room is a child of God, loved with infinite love. More than we can even begin to fathom. And so my hope and my prayer for all of us, for those of us who have come to that recognition, for those of us who have had that experience, whatever experience of God that we've had, there is always so much more, and it only gets better. The God who is the creator of all that is, I invite you this week at some point in your devotional reading to go and just read through Genesis chapter 1. The God who is transcendent, who can just say the words, and it is so and it is good. The one who created all that is, the cosmos, is the one who knows each and every one of us by name. The one who knows whatever we are going through personally, who knows our fears, our hopes, our anxieties, our ambitions, knows our struggles, our pains, our hurts, our injuries. And one of the most liberating insights that I've ever had is, for some of us, our own pain for ourselves is not nearly as intense as the suffering we feel for those we love the most. Isn't that right? But what is so very liberating is that God cares for your loved one even more than you do. And so we can place whatever is on our hearts and minds in the hands of God. So with that in mind, let's go to God in prayer together. Gracious God, we are indeed grateful to be in this place. We know that just as surely as we can hear the music, just as surely as we can sense the people to our right and to our left, just as surely as the air we breathe, we know that you are with us. We know that there's no place we can be where you are not with us, but we thank you for opportunities like this where we are intentional. The power of intention. When we intentionally gather to encounter you anew. We know that you created us to be one. One in the sense that we are all your children. And yet, due to our fragmentation from within, we live in a world of fragmentation from without. But we thank you for this opportunity to take a break for reality. To take a break from those circumstances that are contrary to your will. And to take a break for a remembrance, a re-coming together. A remembrance of your love for each and every one of us. This morning we would pray that you would help us to have a renewed knowledge, a greater knowledge of that word that we use, love, that word that doesn't even begin to comprehend the reality beyond the word. We're here above all to know you. So make that the intention of our hearts and minds today. Make that the priority. For the time that we are gathered here intentionally, help us to suspend our anxieties and fears. Help us to give our thoughts, our feelings over to you, to trust you. We invite you, living word, to speak to us anew. Speak to us words of comfort. Speak to us words of assurance. Speak to us words of hope. Speak to us words of forgiveness. Speak to us words of healing. Speak to us words of encouragement. And we invite you to speak to us words of challenge. Challenge insofar as you are leading us to grow in our relationship with you, to grow in our faith. Give us the will. We even surrender our will to you. We invite you to direct us as it pleases you to direct us. God, we thank you for your Son. We thank you that he is the one that makes it possible to know who you truly are. We thank you that in him, you, the transcendent one, you have come very near. So help us to sense your presence in the teachings of your Son, in the actions of your Son, as we will witness them in Scripture this morning. Help us to see your intentions by looking at his intentions. And in so doing, we invite you to transform our intentions. These things we ask in the name and for the sake of your Son, even as we pray the prayer that he taught us when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven." Amen. I invite those who are serving to come forward at this time. This is our opportunity for offerings. I was thinking about that throughout this week. What a wonderful opportunity for offerings this is. Offerings that are extended to us. God in Christ offers us the opportunity to encounter God anew. God tries to communicate with us in any number of ways. God speaks to us through the written word. God speaks to us through the living word. God seeks to demonstrate who God is. So let's pause for a moment. Whatever may be going through our minds, what might be distracting us, whether it's something going on in our personal lives or just the chatter, you know the chatter that sometimes goes through your minds. Let's suspend all of that for a moment and recognize the opportunity that we have. This is no insignificant thing we're getting ready to do. The God of all creation took on human form. That's how important it is in God's mind, in God's heart, to reach us, to say, "This is who I am. I want you to know me. I created you for relationship with me. And all that you're looking for begins with me. And all that is good emanates from me." And so when we come to this table, we remember that the God of all that is was fulfilled in human form, embodied, so that we could encounter God in new and more profound ways. And so this bread represents the human form. This cup represents the life of God. In Hebrew scriptures, they understood that the life is in the blood. That's how they described it. Now, I know there are some strange associations with that, and I get it. It seems strange to me. I didn't grow up in the church. What do you mean, the body and the blood? That's weird. It represents the very life of God. And so we take that life into ourselves, and our life is enriched and made whole. It is eternal, which is more than chronological. It's qualitative as much as quantitative. Our lives are made more and more whole. It just keeps getting better and better and better. It's a foretaste, so to speak, of what we have to look forward to when life is truly fulfilled. We have the offering. We have an opportunity to pray. We can always pray. But for many of us, we're going through a season that can be dark. And so we need to be reminded that God in Christ, the light of the world, shines in the darkness. The darkness will never, ever, ever overcome it. And then we have an opportunity. It is a gift from God for us to be able to give back to God. It's God's very gift to us to be able to give. I hope we can see that. See, God is not seeking for us to give in an obligatory kind of way, out of obligation or duty or responsibility or a law or a principle. That's not what that's about. It's always about relationship. And so we get to grow in our identity as God's children as we give. God is love, and love demonstrated gives, serves, even sacrificially. So when we do that, we are growing. We're actually, that's a gift to us to give sacrificially. We're becoming more and more and more like God when we do that. We give with our finances, and that's not the only way. Certainly not. There are some of us in this room, we're going through financial hardship, so I do not want you to hear me saying anything that would suggest that God wants to be a burden upon you. But that's part of the beauty of relationship. We're called to be in relationship, so we have a sense of what God is calling us to do. And God is not calling us to do anything more than God is calling us to do. And God is not calling us to do anything less than God is calling us to do. And the only way to know that is through relationship. And so that's what this is all about. Communion, prayer, offering, it's all about relationship. And so you are invited to respond to these and others. We have some, do we still have some paper over here? If you have a burden that you're carrying and you want to put it on the cross, we have some nails that are already up there. You can write it down, fold it, place it on a nail. The elders pray for it. We have a group of a prayer team that meets on Thursdays. They will be happy to pray for it. And some of us, we need to be reminded that we can place that on the cross. So respond to any and all of these offerings as you feel so led.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the blessings that you give us. And as we come to this table of remembrance, make us ever mindful of what it represents, the bread, the broken body of Jesus. And in sharing the cup, we share the most precious gift of all, your love poured out for us. Father, we ask that you make us have a life more pleasing to you. In your name we pray. Amen.
That night in the upper room with his disciples, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it. He said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also, and he said, "This cup is the eternal covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you partake of it in remembrance of me." These are the gifts of God for each and every one of us, the children of God. Thanks be to God. Come and be fed. Come and be made whole. You're welcome to come as you feel so led.
you're not good enough. He told you you're not right. He told you you're not strong enough to put up a good fight. When he told you you're not worthy. When he told you you're not loved. When he told you you're not beautiful.
All right, I invite you to pull out either your bulletins or if you happen to print the outline that has the readings in it. I see you did. You know that warms my heart when I see that, when folks take the time to print that out. That's not a hint, I'm just saying. I love when folks are engaged and eager students learning, as we all should be eager students learning. I love to learn, and so that's the kind of minister I became. It's the kind of minister I was called to be, and there's a whole story behind that that I'll spare you, but it was a powerful experience where my primary calling is teacher, and part of the reason I love that is because more than anything else, I love to learn. I love to learn about the goodness of God. I love to learn about the nature of God, and as every time I learn, I want to share so much of it, and that's the reason I go so long sometimes. So I hope you will forgive me, because my intentions, that word, my intentions, I believe, are good. And sometimes we do that. We project onto other people a lot of who we are. And because I love to learn so much, I always just assume other people are here to learn as well. This morning, we're going to learn some big words. You're going to learn three very big words. For those of you who saw the outline, did you notice them? Soteriology. Eschatology. Parousia. Who wants to learn three words this morning that maybe you didn't know prior to showing up? They're beautiful, powerful words, and we want to come to know them a little bit more. But before we do that, let's review very quickly. Look, I have all kinds of time this morning. But I decided this week, and I thought I was going to do that earlier. I'm going to tighten these up a little bit for your sake, for mine, so that I can stay a little bit on track and so that I can be mindful. We have a lot of small groups now that we want to be mindful of, a lot of people being directed, and that's another wonderful opportunity to grow in your faith and to learn is to be a part of a small group where you can dialogue, because for the most part, what we're doing in here is mostly a monologue, though sometimes you'll hear me say, did you get that? Did you catch that? Do I need to repeat that? And if I do, I'm being sincere, you can always say, yes, yes, describe that in another way, and I'm happy to. But one of the ways that we learn and grow is through a small group where we hear other people's stories. There's a little more time to hear people's perspectives. So if you're not a part of a small group, I encourage you to become part of one. And if there's not one that is suited to your particular needs at this time, we will create one. So you can see me, you can see Jillian after this service, and we can either direct you or find out how we can create one. But last week, I want us to reinforce something we saw last week, and that was the power of words. Remember, the power of words. The power of the Word incarnate. There's the Word, which contains the Word of God in the words of Scripture. There is the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh. For me personally, Jesus, the Word incarnate, is the rule. Jesus is the highest authority. So I interpret Scripture through the lens of Jesus. I try to interpret all reality through the lens of Jesus. I try to interpret current affairs and events and all kinds of things. I try to interpret all of that through the lens of the Word, which is the Word of Jesus. For those of you who are familiar with Scripture, and a lot of us are not, I know until I was in my mid-20s was the first time I really started engaging Scripture. And some of us are more or less aware of what all is contained in that collection of books that we call the Bible. But Jesus would say occasionally, I know it's been said, but I say. And so for those of us who consider ourselves Christian, trying to be more Christ-like, then we look to Jesus as the authoritative one. And so we look particularly at his teachings and what he found of particular relevance and what he emphasized to be of importance. And we're going to look at that in a few moments. But we saw this, and this is very important for us to understand. God is the creator of all it is. God speaks, it is so, it is good. So go ahead and go back and look at Genesis chapter 1 this week. So I hadn't intended to come in and say that twice, so since I have, might ought to pay attention to that. Go back and read Genesis chapter 1. Now I've said it 3 times, so you are without excuse. God speaks. What God speaks creates, gives life, and it is good. God has created us. We are created in the image of God. God has given us a measure of God's power. The difference between us and God is God's nature is complete and perfect. We have a God-given nature, and we also have a human condition. Our nature is that we are children of God. Our condition is such that our thoughts, our experiences have led to a condition that at times is consistent with our true nature and often is inconsistent with our true nature. This is one of those times I'm going to say, are you with me? And if you're not, please raise your hand because this is important. Are you with me? We have a divine nature and we have a human condition. Because of our human condition, which sometimes is contrary to the will of God, we have the power, the capacity to speak things that are life-giving, life enriching, and we have the capacity to speak things that are life diminishing. We saw that word wicked. I don't like that word. I don't even like the way it sounds, do you? But we saw that word wicked, that we may have interpreted in a number of different ways or associated it with any particular, we saw that word wicked means to inflict suffering, to cause pain in another, to cause offense. Do you see how these words like wicked, all of a sudden they're brought from some abstract or reality that's just swirling about out there, and it becomes very interpersonal, relational. Do you see? That word wicked is by definition And by necessity, I should say, relational. And it is by definition relational. It's how we treat one another. So even the words we speak can be wicked. Now, here's one of the worst forms of wickedness, if we're going to use that terrible word. Sometimes people will use scripture in wicked ways. They will use scripture to inflict suffering on another. So we want to be very careful, don't we? We do not want to inflict pain and suffering and offense in another. So that's one of those words, some of these words that we need to learn the meanings of words, because what can also happen over time is that a word that was originally meant to foster life, over time it can be used in such a way that there are associations with that word now that are different from what it was originally intended to convey. And that's of no small import. Because what now happens if it's been passed down from generations and generations and generations, and a word that evokes within us, words that can be positive, a word that evokes within us positive sentiments because of the context in which it's been used, but is actually causing suffering in another? Are you with me? What if it's a form of pride about who we are? It's a word that evokes pride in who we are. But it can create a situation that in our pride, in our association with this word that evokes pride, we look at others as somehow we wouldn't use a word like inferior, but we think we're a little bit better than they are. So now that word that we're taking great pride in is inflicting suffering. And to inflict suffering on another is to do what? Behave how? Wickedly. So we want to be very, very careful about the power of words. We're going to move on this week with intention. The power of intention. I try to look for images to communicate as I send out that weekly email, and sometimes it's easier, and I'm actually trying to learn how to create them myself rather than find one. But it was interesting that there are a number of people that have been quoted that talk about intention in a negative way. Intention doesn't matter. The only thing that matters is what you do. The only thing that matters is the outcome. I understand what's being communicated, but I don't agree with that. I think our intentions matter. And I think we have a scripture reading this morning that suggests the same. So let's jump into our scripture readings. We're going to read through these, and then we're going to jump into our message for this morning. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. Prior to this, if you read in chapter 3, there's this regular discussion about our hearts. Hearts being hardened. Hearts not responding. So we need to pray that our hearts will be softened. And there takes great courage in that, doesn't there? Why do our hearts get hardened? Because we're afraid. We sang it, didn't we? We're afraid. We're afraid to get hurt. We're afraid to be wrong. I get that. So if our intention, our prayer, needs to be twofold then. Our prayer needs to be that our hearts would be softened, but that our intention is to know God as God is. That's an important statement. Not as we would have God to be, but as God is. See, some of us are afraid that God may show up and show us God's self in a way that is contrary than we know God. And we're afraid because we, like the people we're going to see, have a different intention. See, for some of us, we need God to be the way we need God to be. And so the intention of our heart is not to actually know God beyond how I need God to be. And we have our reasons if we're being honest before God. God, I need you to be this way for thus and so. Do you know what it would cost me if I saw you in a way that is contrary to the way that I see you now? Do you know how that would affect my relationships? Do you know how that would affect my job? Do you know how that would affect my friendships? Do you know how that would affect my favorite hobby? See, we don't say that right out loud. But we need God to be the way we need God to be. So our prayer needs to be twofold: to know God as God is and to soften our hearts. That means to be vulnerable to it being some other way. Indeed, the Word of God is what? Living and active. That's a word right there for someone. The Word of God is living and active. God still speaks. God did not stop speaking 2,000 years ago. Do you understand the importance of that statement? For some people, the Word of God is closed. It's not fresh. It's not available to us now in a living way. It's contained on pages and sealed. No one says it that way, but that's how they operate. The Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing till it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. The power of intention. One day, Luke chapter 5, one day, while Jesus was teaching, Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting nearby. They had come from every village of Galilee and Judea and from Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was with him to heal. That's an interesting statement too, isn't it? The power of the Lord was with him to heal. It almost suggests that it wasn't always with him, doesn't it? How do we make sense of that? Somebody needed to be healed. And the relationship with Jesus to the Father, the Creator, was such, Jesus only did the will of God. That's the oneness of Jesus and God. That's the oneness that we've been called to. So he didn't just go around with this power all the time. His power, his greatest power, was to recognize the will of God in any given situation. And the reason he could do that was because he was in such close relationship with God that they were one. He would hear the words of God the Father, the Creator, the Mother of all that is, the wisdom that is available to all of us, personified and beyond. What he heard, he spoke. What he saw the Father wanting him to do, he did. So the power of the Lord was with him. This is giving us an opportunity to grow in our understanding of God and Jesus in that relationship that we're called to. It's a mystery, and yet we can grow in our learning. Just then, some men came carrying a paralyzed man on a bed. They were trying to bring him in and lay him before Jesus, but finding no way to bring him in because of the crowd, they went up on the roof and let him down with his bed through the tiles into the middle of the crowd in front of Jesus. In case I don't get to have an opportunity to come back to this, what would you be willing to do to get to Jesus? What would you be willing to do? And they let him down with his bed through the tiles into the middle of the crowd in front of Jesus. When he saw their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven you." Then the scribes and the Pharisees began to question, "Who is this? Who is this who is speaking blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone?" When Jesus perceived their questionings, he answered them, "Why do you raise such questions in your hearts? Which is easier to say, 'Your sins are forgiven you,' or to say, 'Stand up and walk'? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins," he said to the one who was paralyzed, "I say to you, stand up and take your bed and go to your home." Immediately he stood up before them, took what he had been lying on, and went to his home glorifying God. Amazement. Think about that word, amazement. Seized all of them. Seized them. And they glorified God and were filled with awe. We need awe in our lives, don't we? Awe. To be overcome with awe. Mystery transcends our categories. Saying, "We have seen strange things today." I hope we see strange things, miraculous things, powerful things, the power of intention. There is a good chance I will not get through this sermon, as you know. But what I will not do is take you too far. Wherever we get is where we get. Because I don't want to rush through these important things. So if we come back next week and continue this, we will. The power of intention. What is intention? What do we mean by intention? Anyone? What do we mean by intention? Purpose. What else? Planning. Purpose, planning. What else? Hope. I love that. Hope. We wouldn't be moving towards something if there was no hope, right? We're hoping for something. That's good. What else? Intention. In its root form, it can mean to strain toward, to stretch toward, to exert oneself. It can mean to direct one's mind and energy toward. The power of intention. Fundamental intentions are important. Fundamental intentions. And I like that we heard hope, and there was one that came here that was similar. Objective. Purpose. What is the purpose of our lives collectively? Why are we here? What is the purpose of our existence? Philosophers have been asking that question from ancient days. And every one of us at some point needs to ask that question. Why am I here? What is the purpose of my existence? Why are human beings here? What are we even here for? And so, Greek philosophers, by the way, all truth is God's truth. Do not get nervous, please. I started to say that more emphatically. I'm saying please, honestly. Do not get nervous if I quote a Greek philosopher. All truth is God's truth, and the truth that is available to us was available to Greek philosophers as well. Aquinas, so that you don't get nervous if I quote Aristotle, Aquinas used Aristotelian thought, Aristotle's thought, to form his theology. And so Aristotle said this. It was a way of helping us. It helps us clarify our thought. We don't have to believe what Aristotle believed, but we can employ his way of clarifying some things. And so he said, every action and every choice is aimed at something we deem good. Otherwise, we wouldn't choose to behave in that way. We're getting something out of it. Doesn't mean that every choice is good, but we've deemed it good. Now, I have to be careful with certain things, like it's better for me if I have only available to me a little bit of chocolate cake. Because if there's a whole chocolate cake, I know it is good. And I will eat more of it than is good for me. But it tastes so good that I can eat more of it. So you get a sense of this. This is what we mean by good. We deem it good. Good because I get pleasure out of it. So every action, every choice is aimed at something good. So they ask the question, and this is important, what is the ultimate good? What is the end, the good, the aim, the telos that all things is pointing toward? Because if everything is a means to some other end, what is that ultimate end? Each one of us, whether consciously or unconsciously, is living towards something. And so what we want to do, again, is be vulnerable. God, what am I living for? What is my ultimate aim? What is truly my ultimate aim? Have I made a God that is lesser than God? Is there a God in my life that I'm serving more than you? The God of all creation, the God who truly is God. You who are God. Like, do we ask that question? Or again, are we afraid that we may discover that there's something else that we're living toward, an end that is not God? And that's where we want to be vulnerable to the possibility that we're not. And this is grace. This is grace. Some people think that people who emphasize grace go too far. It covers everything. Yes, it does. It also covers our will and gives us the strength. So in the sense that, yes, let's say that we discover that we're living towards something that is not God as God is. For some of us, until we understand grace, we would be afraid to hear that, understand that. We wouldn't want to know that, because then we would think we're guilty. You with me? But once we recognize that we are forgiven, Jesus said to the paralytic, "Your sins are forgiven." Blasphemy. Jesus knows God as God is so well, he can say to anyone, "Your sins are forgiven." And they are. We need to get bolder in saying, if that's what someone needs to hear, "Your sins are forgiven." A better way to say it is, you are loved unconditionally, just as you are. If you never change, God will never change God's mind about you. If you never change your mind about God, God will never change God's mind about you. You can throw his son on a cross, and he still will not change his mind about you. Your sins are forgiven. Receive it. Now, some people get nervous when you say, "Oh, good gracious, if you say that, then this world is going to go to hell." If you tell everyone that they are loved unconditionally, infinitely, that if they never change anything, well, people will do whatever they want to do. If God's love just covers it all, right? It's God's love that constrains my behavior. Not the consequences of hell. That wouldn't be loving God. We serve God because we love God. And we love God because God first loves us. And when we get that love, we don't want to do anything but what God wants us to do. And when we're outside of God's love, there is this conviction. And you have it and I have it. You know you do. Those things that we keep wanting to put down and try. But it's God's love. See, as we grow in God's love, it will overcome all. So we grow more in love, not fear. Fear is a spiral of destruction. I'm condemned. God doesn't love me anymore. Now I have despair. I need medication. Whatever that is, whatever form that is, I need anesthesia. You with me? God's grace is the power to overcome sin, not just be forgiven of sin, to overcome it. This is good news, folks. Y'all are looking at me like, "I don't know about him." To correct our behavior because we fear God is not love of God. When we recognize how much God loves us, then behavior gets corrected. So our intentions matter. Our intention is to know God. When we know God, everything falls into place. I'm going to skip the college president's soteriology, but I'm going to tell you what soteriology is. For time's sake, I can tell you this. I was listening. I went to a talk. It happened to be here in Washington. It was to a civic group, and there was a college president who was the keynote speaker that day. And as he began to talk about some things that were being implemented and some of the things that he was hoping to constrain, and as he began to articulate the whole purpose of an education, I knew what his soteriology was. I said to Valerie, Valerie and I happened to be together. I walked away and I knew what his soteriology was. Soteriology is the doctrine of salvation that a lot of thinkers since the time of Jesus and before, but for those from a Christian perspective, have thought out what this salvation means. What does it mean that Jesus came to save us? How do we understand that? Their doctrine of how we understand the cross is a part of our soteriology. But I could tell that this person's, and we're going to use another word, eschatology, what the fulfillment of all things will look like, and the parousia, when and how Jesus returns. So we've learned three big words. You want to hear them again? Soteriology, the doctrine of salvation. Eschatology, when God's will is fulfilled in all ways, when all that is fulfilled needs to be fulfilled, is fulfilled. It is heaven. That's eschatology. When heaven is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is fulfilled. The parousia is when Jesus returns or how Jesus returns. See, there are different understandings of that. But this particular college president, I knew, because what he said was the students need to be busy just getting their education so that they can become, at some point, contributing members essentially to the market system in the United States, that that's what the point of an education was. There were others that were concerned about matters of injustice, matters of inequality, fairness to all groups on campus. Do you hear in those distinctions a difference in their soteriology? In other words, what Jesus came to do? One is though heaven is something that happens primarily after we die. Another one is concerned with how we are to operate and what Jesus was actually doing in this world. We prayed a prayer that we pray each week, didn't we? And it's called whose prayer? The Lord's Prayer. Who is the Lord? Jesus. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's soteriology. That's salvation. That's not salvation merely for the afterlife. That's salvation for now. So we have three doctrines that make all the difference in the world: how we understand God, how we understand the human condition, what salvation is, and it's important for us to say, now, how do you know? How do you know? How do I know? Because in this room, some people would say the Bible is the only place you look, period. If you want to know who God is, if you want to know what the human condition is, if you want to know what it means to be saved, the Bible is the only place. For some people in this room, you would say the Bible is the primary, not the only, but the primary, the most important one. Now, for those of you who say the Bible is the only one, even for those of you who share that in common, each of you has a different understanding of God. Did you think that through now? Even if you say that a particular source is the source and the only source, the ones who say that have a different understanding of who God is, what the human condition is, and what salvation means. So how do we know? Even if we could reduce it to one collection of books, there would still be differences of opinion. That's the point I'm trying to make. So still, how do we know? One of the things we can do is soften our hearts. Say, God, show me my heart. God, show me if I desire to know you. Show me if I desire to know salvation as salvation. Show me if I desire to know the human condition as it actually is. Two things I need to say very, very quickly. I put it down so you know I'm trying to do it quickly. And we're doing great on time. Thank God. There's the gospel according to Jesus. There's the gospel according to Paul. That's the reason I introduced two words to you: eschatology and parousia. Paul was a human being like you and me. Paul was a Pharisee like the Pharisees that he encountered. Very devout, very sincere, very devoted people, very pious. They took their religion seriously. Paul had grown up in a particular context. How many of you know that your context will shape the way you view God and the way you view Jesus? Paul was not an exception to that. Students of the Bible recognize that there is a gospel according to Jesus and there's a gospel according to Paul. Paul was in love with Jesus, make no mistake, which is an opportunity for humility for us. How many of you would raise your hand and say you love Jesus more than Paul did? That you would be willing to be beaten with rods, be in an empty, wet, cold jail cell? That you would be willing to face death at any point? How many of us would say, right now, that's me, sign me up? Some of us might. But I doubt that any of us love Jesus more than Paul. But even in Paul's desire to love Jesus, he's not Jesus. Jesus is Jesus. And what Jesus was concerned about, so Paul, through his understanding, he thought Jesus was coming back any day now. Any moment, that's the parousia. Jesus is coming back. And then when that happens, all things will be fulfilled. Jesus came announcing the kingdom of God on earth as it is in heaven. He wasn't merely concerned about the afterlife. He was transforming the world in which we live today. He was saying, my followers will witness to the kingdom of God today. My followers will witness to love, true freedom, true equality of all God's children, true justice for all God's children, which is not retributive justice. You've done something, now you got to pay. It's restorative justice that brings someone back into relationship, that does what is necessary to bring someone back into the community, where everyone, justice, is given their due of dignity and respect. Now, this is what I want us to see. And I'm just going to give you one example, and I'll come back to this next week. This week, I'm closing, so this is one of those opportunities to say he's closing, so I tuned out because he talked too long, but this is one of those moments. This week, I encountered something. I went into a restaurant. I happened to be speaking with someone about some wonderful things that can happen in this community that I pray you will be a part of, because God is on the move in this church and through this church, and we're looking to partner with others. But I was sitting in a restaurant, and I happened to be aware of a situation where two young people, one was kicked out of his house by his parents because of, in my estimation, a wicked reading of Scripture that inflicted pain, hurt. There was another young woman whom I happen to know has an eating disorder. Evidently, she doesn't feel beautiful enough in our society. How many of you know that people are starving for the love of God now? How many people are out there who have heard nothing but condemnation and judgment from churches that are scared to death to run to the one they need? Paul had an urgency to share the grace of God with people as quickly as possible because Jesus was coming back any day. My prayer for us is that we have the same urgency of Paul. There's not a day to waste. There's not a moment to waste. People are dying for a lack of hope and love and grace and acceptance and inclusion and welcome. We're waiting on God. God's waiting on us. My prayer for us this morning is that we'll take our doctrine of God, the human condition, and salvation very, very seriously. My prayer for us is that we will share this message of God's love, infinite love and acceptance, with an urgency that not only saves people's souls and spirits, it saves their lives here and now. Amen. If there's anyone here who has never made a confession of faith, Jesus is the one to reveal God's infinite love. He's the one to follow, not just believe in, follow. If there's anyone here who's not a part of a community of faith, we are committed to following Jesus today. We are committed to making of this world the kingdom of God on earth as it is in heaven, so that every child of God knows that they're a child of God, that they know God's love. If you want to be a part of that mission, you're in the right place. Come on and join us. You can come and see me. You can come up here and do it by confession of faith. You can transfer a membership. If you're a little bit shy, that's cool. I get it. Come see me outside of this, and we'll share that. Membership is partnership. That's what that means. That's what it means. We're partners in God's mission. It's not a club. It's a partnership. If you want to partner with that, we would love to have you. If you want to rededicate your life, I hope we all do every week, every day, you can rededicate your life. If you want to rededicate it publicly, you can do that. If you've never been baptized and say, listen, I identify with Jesus. He's the one. I want to be baptized into who he is. We will baptize you. Come talk to me. We'll arrange it. Whatever your need, if you have a prayer concern, if there's a burden, we'll have a couple of elders over here. They'll pray with you. I invite you to stand as you're able. As we sing our hymn of commitment, as we respond in the way that God is calling us to respond.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, and when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, and when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance. chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Oh, shame no longer has a place to hide. And I am not a captive to the lies. Oh, I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. Oh, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And this power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. And there's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Change. There's power that can empty out a grave. And there's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. There's power in your name. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
And now may the love of God that surpasses all understanding, the love that casts out all fear, the love that saves our spirits, our souls, our lives, the love that makes of this world the kingdom of God on earth as it is in heaven, where nothing is missing and nothing is broken. May that love guard and sustain our hearts this day and forevermore. Amen.
My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear, it doesn't stand a chance. Fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear, it doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear, it doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.